Hello and welcome. My name is Jonathan Vita, and in this lecture, we're going to be looking at Alan Turing's Turing test, which is from his famous article, Computing, Machinery, and Intelligence. An overview of what we're going to be covering today. First, we're going to talk about the philosophical problem known as the problem of other minds. And then we're going to look at a pretty plausible argument for thinking that there are other minds than just your own. And then we're going to shift this into talking about not just other people, but also machines and whether computers have minds and whether they can think. This brings us then to Turing's specific way of trying to answer this problem, to answer this kind of question. And as we're going along, we're also going to get a better understanding what is really what we're going for if we're calling something artificially intelligent, and then also look at some concerns and objections to the Turing test. So the philosophical problem of other minds. Now, the basic idea of this question is you know pretty well that you have a mind. You're at least you're pretty sure about this. You're aware of your own thoughts. You know exactly how you feel about certain kinds of things that you like might know, like what you're experiencing right now, the colors, what you hear, what you feel, what you touch, and so on and so forth. But your awareness of yourself, even though it's like pretty obvious to you, that you have, it might not be obvious exactly why you think that anybody else that you look at is also something that has a mind too. And so the question is, why would we think that anyone, anything, has a mind as well? After all, I can't observe your thinking. I can look at your body and I can see different things that you do. But I can't see the colors that you see. I can't hear the sounds that you hear. I can't get inside your head and hear your internal monologue as you're thinking. I can't see what you're imagining as you're imagining it. And so, since I can't directly observe what's going on inside your mind, why would I think that you actually have these experiences like I do? And after all, why think that anyone has any experiences like you do, let alone anyone at all? So we might have very different experiences. Like I can see a rose and see one color, and you can see a rose and see a different color. But that's a slightly different problem. The question more here is just why think that you experience anything at all? Why couldn't it just be that you behave a lot like I do, but there's nothing actually going on between the ears? So why think, similarly, that any of your decisions are conscious and deliberate, that you're aware of what you're doing? Now, it may be obvious to you, but the question is, how can you know about the way other people do? A lot of people do things by habit and they don't think it through. And so you might think it's possible that somebody could be completely in autopilot so that no one is actually experiencing or knowing anything of what they're doing. There's nothing going on. They're just acting like they're thinking, like they're experiencing stuff, but they don't actually have anything going on. Now, we do think that other people have minds. The question is just, why would we think this? So the problem is not like, hey, you guys shouldn't think that there are any other minds than your own. The question is like, what are the reasons? What's the justification for thinking that there are? Now, just starting from like an obvious point, it seems pretty clear that you have a mind and you think that other people do too, that there are other human beings that do too. And so your confidence level, whether something has a mind, is going to be really high for some cases and really low for other cases. Something where it's likely that they have a mind, it's going to be like you and me. But you're going to be pretty confident that a rock doesn't, that some stones or some sticks or other inanimate things just don't have anything going on. They're not experiencing anything when you kick them or snap them or whatever. So you're pretty sure that you have a mind and other humans do, but you're pretty sure that rocks don't. And the there's going to be a big difference between the two, and there's going to be a lot in the middle. And where exactly we wanted to say that something does finally get like this internal consciousness, these experiences on the inside, it's not going to be entirely clear where we should demarcate this does and this doesn't, because like maybe we just not only do we not know how to communicate with them to figure it out, but we're just not sure if they kind of have the same kind of structure that would allow them to be capable of these types of things. So a Venus flytrap, a fly lands on it, it closes shut. Is it because it felt it that it closed shut? I don't know. Worms, they wriggle and writhe and so on and so forth. Do they feel pain when they're being put on a hook? It seems like they're in pain, but are they experiencing anything? Maybe. A little bit more obvious, it seems like mice have something going on consciously, and I realize there's a lot of debate apparently on whether cats do, but maybe not so much for dogs. So the question is just like kind of what is going to fall in the middle that we're able to recognize as having a mind too, having a mind as well. So we're probably not going to say so for dandelions, but we probably will for monkeys. Now, as a preview here, where we need to like demarcate, it's not obvious, but the big question that we're going to be asking is whether we should be including robots or machines or computers in this as well, and whether we can answer that if we get better and better technology, if there's going to be a certain point at which it actually meets that threshold, whatever that threshold is. Now, to make some headway into seeing how this would be a problem, it's a little helpful to kind of go back to what René Descartes was saying about a bunch of different things. So now you might recognize from Descartes that he gave a bunch of different arguments saying something like, I know that I exist, and it's obvious to me whenever I even pose the question, like whether I'm thinking or if I'm doubting or any kind of other thing, it's just obvious to me that I exist. And so in this argument, he's giving a huge priority on that first person perspective view where you see and you're aware of yourself, and it's just so obvious from the inside. Now, if you think about that argument though, just because I can say, I think, therefore I am, that argument works when I pose the question for myself, but I can't use that same reasoning to think about whether you exist. And likewise, you can use that argument and realize that you exist and that it's obvious that you can conclude that, but you can't use that same reasoning to think that I exist. So there's something about this that says like this argument works really, really well from the inside. As soon as you can pose the question, this argument works for you. And anybody can use this argument and it works for them too, but they can't use it to think about others and the minds that they have. And so it's only going to be convincing from the inside. Now, René Descartes also talks a bit later when talking about the piece of wax thought experiment, where he's kind of trying to figure out like if I am analyzing the character and the qualities of some hunk of wax. Strictly speaking, I'm not seeing or feeling the wax, I'm seeing or feeling the qualities that the wax has. What's actually the wax? What's like really there underneath all of those characteristics? That's something I don't have access to with my experiences. My mind can judge and recognize that that's there. So even though we talk like I saw this thing, really I'm only seeing the qualities that that thing has. And so he gives this picture here that if we're careful with our language, we can recognize this distinction. So he says, if I look out my window and I see men crossing the square, as it just happens I've done, I would normally say that I see men themselves, just as I would say I see the wax. Yet, do I see any more than just hats and coats, which conceal automata or automatons? The question is like, hey, I don't necessarily see human beings. I see their coats. I see the thing that's covering them, that's outside them. I don't see what's going on underneath. And so the question here is, or the application here is that this is true for human beings as well. So we only see the wax's qualities, but we recognize with our mind that there's something going on underneath, and we judge that there's some substance that's holding all together. Well, the same thing. Descartes says, "I judge that they are men." So I see coats and hats, and I go, "Oh, those are people." And so something which was rather obvious when he was talking about this kind of stuff before, if he's really careful, he's recognizing that he doesn't actually see them. His mind supplies the information that his eyes can't. And so the import here is that just as I only see your behavior and the body that you have, that doesn't mean that I see your mind. I understand what's going on underneath, but somehow I judge that you have a mind. With my mind, I can tell there's something else going on there underneath that explains your behavior, say. So we have this common view that, like everybody else, like all these other individuals, have minds too. And the question is, like, what would justify it? Since I can't observe your mind directly, then how would I know? And it may be totally normal and natural and common to assume this. That's not the concern. The question is just like, can we justify our assumption? So we make this judgment that goes beyond our experience. If we never can experience it, then how come this doesn't seem like a little bit of a leap? And so one plausible way of going about this is to think of this by an argument by analogy. So you know what it's like inside you, so you just basically say, well, it's got to apply to other people too. So just think about just a simple case. Suppose your friend is angry with you, or they're just angry in general for something else. Maybe somebody ate their cheesecake or something, and they're just like they're angry and they're sad that they've been deprived of their cheesecake. And so you want to know, like, well, how can I tell that they're angry? Well, you might check for different behavior that they're exhibiting. You might read their face. They're scrunched up. You might look at their composure, like crossing their arms, things like that. How they talk, they just might grr sounds, all that other stuff. And you might just say, well, I know what I do. When I have that kind of behavior, it's because I'm angry. And the straightforward thing is, well, they're not that different from me, so they're probably angry. They do the same behavior as I do when I'm angry, so they're angry. And this seems like a really straightforward way to go about this. And so the question is, like, is this a legitimate way of reasoning about this? So let's come up with a very straightforward, formal argument to present this. So premise one, I have thoughts and experiences, and they explain a lot of my actions. So my thoughts and all that, they cause me to do various different things. I think about how I don't have cheesecake anymore, and I'm like, ah, this is crap. And so I get angry or whatever. And so I have thoughts and experiences, and they explain why I do the things I do. But like other human beings, they're pretty similar to me. Like we have lots of things in common, not just like the fact that we're in the same species, but just like a whole host of other different things about how we behave in certain kinds of patterns and so on. So we're very similar in the kinds of actions that we do. There might be a lot of differences, sure, but we're similar. We have a lot of in common. Now, if we are very similar, then probably they have thoughts and experiences that explain their actions. Now, if that's true, then probably they have thoughts and experiences that explain a lot of their actions too. So it's I have this explanatory relation, my thoughts, my behavior, and they're similar to me. But if they're similar to me, then probably they have that relation too. And so conclusion, they have this mind there that fits in this role of explaining why the behavior is the way it is. Now, so this is just strictly speaking an argument from analogy, and that's just basically like two things. If you compare them, they've got a lot in common. So then you analyze this further thing that maybe you don't know. So like A and B have traits like WXY in common. This first thing also has this other trait Z. And so that means, well, probably this other one has that trait as well. So you can see this with other arguments, like with William Paley and his watchmaker argument. These two things, they both seem to be designed. This one clearly has a designer, so maybe the other one has a designer too. So this is the same kind of structure of argument. What kind of relationship explains why I have the behavior I do? Well, I have a mind. Well, maybe other people do too. And that may be the best explanation for the behavior that they have, is that they have a mind. Now, the question is, like, whether this argument would work well for a robot. Like, there's going to be immediately some differences, like, I'm a biological thing and a robot isn't. But the question is, like, could a robot have the same behavior, but do this behavior for totally different reasons? Like, maybe I run around and I start to sweat and things like that. And so I go to grab like a Gatorade and so on. Well, maybe you only see me like grabbing a Gatorade in like a rush, like, oh my gosh, I gotta grab this. A robot could do the same thing, but like it would be silly to think that it's because they're warm and they're sweating. They might have like a bunch of different reasons why they would grab a Gatorade feverishly. Maybe there's another reason how they can like process electrolytes or something. I have no idea. But like you can do this for a whole host of other different things. Like I type up stuff on the computer and it sounds like nonsense sometimes. A computer does that too, but the reason why I do it is because like I'm trying to sound like a lolcat, you know, something about cats being like cute or whatever, and the robot's just doing it because it's been like scripted. Here are ways to, you know, mess up the English language, and it sounds funny, and so people will laugh at mine, and somebody will laugh at the robots, but like totally different reasons why like we generated the same type of thing. You need to keep doing this for basically anything else. Like when I think there are like two cars in the parking lot, like a robot can probably come up with the same answer, number two. But like the reasons why it might be different. Like I'm counting cars and the robot is counting, you know, tires and dividing by a certain number. I have no idea. But the question is more just like, do they have the same underlying explanatory relations so that they actually understand what's going on that would explain their behavior.